Ashton rang the bell for us this morning, and I think his feet went about 4 feet off the ground when he was pulling the rope. Good morning, and welcome to Good Shepherd Lutheran Church on this beautiful, beautiful November Sunday. A special welcome to the family and friends of Maverick McDaniel who are here to surround and support him as today he is baptized and named as a beloved child of God. Today, following worship, in fact, immediately following worship, we will gather for a special congregational meeting here in the sanctuary, and so you'll note that we'll be seated for the sending song, and then all confirmed members are welcome to vote then if a vote is taken. We are in the midst of preparing for the community Thanksgiving dinner once again, hosting that here at the church. Please, at this time, visit the sign-up sheet, which is on the table right near the church office, and that's what's needed at this time, is to visit that sign-up sheet so that we can continue making plans. Help is needed with preparation, serving, and then food items. So please visit that list today. Tonight, there's a mystery dinner, and there's a time that's been adjusted. Please note, if you'd signed up to go to the mystery dinner, the time adjustment is to 5:30 here at the church. Next Sunday, we will gather for a potluck following worship, so it's next Sunday at approximately 10 a.m. downstairs in the fellowship hall. There's a tailgating theme with the promise that you'll be done and ready to head out the door before the Vikings noon game next week. So that's next week, a potluck. All are welcome to that following worship. And then personal care items are being collected, and there's some boxes out collecting those. So in the coming weeks, if you can remember that as you do some shopping in the weeks to come, those personal care items will be made into gift bags for the food shelf clients. And then finally, in addition to all the announcements that you can read on your own in the bulletin, with Christian sympathy, I announced that Rosalie Rasmussen died this morning, and the funeral is tentatively scheduled for Friday morning, but please visit the Bruss Heitner website for all the funeral arrangements as they will be finalized today. So our Christian sympathy is to the family of Rosalie Rasmussen. There's a lot going on today in worship. And so with that, with all this up here, we are not going to have a children's sermon, but at that time, I'll be excusing those kids who want to go to Sunday school at that time. And so just be aware of that. It's All Saints Day as we commemorate that because of Christ, we are all saints. And one of the traditions that we have is to light candles to not only remember those members who passed away this past year, but then you will be invited, and it'll be at the end of worship, to come forward and light a candle in memory of loved ones who have passed away before us, who are now saints in heaven. Those are all the announcements. At this time, I invite you to rise. We're going to sing our opening hymn. It's You Are Holy, and it's 525 in the red hymnal, the ELW. Worship with the confession and forgiveness as printed on the cover of your bulletin. Let us confess our sins before God and one another. Hear us as we lay our sins before you, God, and pray for your forgiveness. We, like your people of old, have not always been faithful. We have heard the words but haven't always believed them. We have been shown the way but haven't always followed. We have been called by you but have often refused the invitation, thinking we know a better way. We ask for your mercy and your forgiveness. The promise of the Lord is as true today as it was in the beginning. We are chosen. We are loved. We are forgiven. Receive now the blessings of God's forgiveness and trust in God's love for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thanks be to God. Amen. And then please join me as we pray together the prayer of the day. You see our failings, Lord, and know the weaknesses of our hearts. Set us right and fill us with love and compassion to serve the people whom you love, working on your behalf and filled with the Spirit of Christ. Amen. Please be seated. And then is Rachel here? Rachel Foreman? Then we will not have Sunday school today.
Thank you. The psalm this morning is from the 62nd chapter, verses 5 through 12, and we will read it responsibly. For God alone my soul waits in silence, for my hope is from him. On God rests my deliverance and my honor. My mighty rock, my refuge is in God. Those of low estate are but a breath. Those of high estate are a delusion. In the balances they go up. They are together lighter than a breath. Once God has spoken, twice have I heard this, that power belongs to God. Here ends the psalm reading.
And now as we continue through our reading of the Bible, we have gotten this far to reading now from the book of Jonah. So a reading from the book of Jonah beginning with chapter 1. Praise to you, O Lord. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, "Go at once to Nineveh, Jonah, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." But Jonah, instead of obeying God, set out to flee from God to Tarshish, the opposite direction, to flee from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and he found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid his fare and he went on board to go with them to Tarshish, away from the presence of God. But the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, such that a mighty storm came upon the sea that the ship threatened to break up. Then the mariners, the sailors, were afraid and they each cried to his own God. And the sailors then turned to Jonah and said, "Tell us why this calamity has come upon us. What is your occupation? Where do you come from? What is your country? And of what people are you?" Jonah replied, saying, "I'm a Hebrew. I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." And hearing this, the men were even more afraid and said to him, "What is this that you have done?" For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord, because Jonah had told them such. So the men, the sailors, said to Jonah, "What shall we do to you that the sea may be quieted down for us?" For the sea was growing more and more tempestuous. He said to them, "Pick me up." Jonah said, "Pick me up and throw me into the sea. Then the sea will quiet down for you. For I know that it is because of me that this great storm has come upon you." So the sailors did that. They picked Jonah up and they threw him into the sea. And when that happened, the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord even more, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord, and they made vows. But the Lord provided for Jonah a large fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of that fish 3 days and three nights, until it spit him onto dry land. And the word of God, the Lord came to Jonah now a second time, again saying, "Jonah, get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." This time Jonah obeyed. Jonah set out and this time went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city. It took 3 days to walk across. Jonah began going into the city, going about a day's walk, and when he reached that point, he stopped and he cried out, saying, 40 days more and Nineveh will be overthrown." The people of Nineveh believed God They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, both great and small, put on sackcloth. And when the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose up to the throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes, the sign of repentance. Then he had a proclamation made in Nineveh. He said this: "By the decree of the king and his nobles, all the people of Nineveh shall turn from their evil ways and from the violence that is in their hands. Who knows? God may relent and change his mind. He may turn from his fierce anger so that we do not perish." When God saw that the people turned away from this, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he said he would bring upon them, and he did not destroy the people of Nineveh. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God. Grace to you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord, our Savior, who is Jesus the Christ. Amen. A Sunday school teacher once taught her students a lesson about worship. The teacher asked the kids if they know, "Why should we be quiet during worship?" One little girl raised her hand and said, "It's so the people can sleep." People do sleep during worship. I've given short sermons, and after one short sermon, it's a miracle, but I have. And after one particularly short sermon, a parishioner left worship with a smile on their face and said, "Boy, that was a short sermon. Now I'm going to have to go home and take a nap this afternoon because it didn't get done this morning." Short sermons are a treat. And this morning you're going to have a double bonus. You're going to have a short sermon about a short sermon. Okay? Our Bible story today is about the prophet Jonah. Some prophets had a lot to say. Isaiah, Jeremiah, they spoke and they spoke and they spoke. Not Jonah. The prophet Jonah, when he proclaimed this message from God, his sermon was one sentence long. The story starts with God telling Jonah to go to Nineveh. "I've chosen you," he said, "to go to Nineveh and preach to the people." Okay? "They're evil. They have just been caught up in their evil ways. Go to Nineveh." Jonah, of course, didn't go to Nineveh. That's kind of the whole drama in the story. It's one of these stories we often teach to kids in Sunday school because of the fish, the whale that swallowed him up. Of course, he headed in the opposite direction. He did not go the way that God asked him to go. He instead went to Joppa, a sea city, jumped on a ship and headed in the opposite direction, running from God, running from his mission. And after a big storm, Jonah ended up overboard. And then, of course, the big drama in the story is how God sent that big fish to swallow him up. He sat in the belly of that fish for 3 days until that fish spit him onto dry land. And God came again and said to Jonah, "Get up, Jonah, go to Nineveh, proclaim the word of God to them, please, Jonah." This time Jonah obeyed. And when he arrived in Nineveh, he preached an 8-word sermon to the people. Now in this modern day and age, Jonah could have stayed home and sent his sermon out on Twitter. Okay, now I preached this sermon on Wednesday and I had the confirmation kids here, and at least I could tell that a few people understood what I meant when I said Jonah would send it out on Twitter, okay? Twitter is a modern day way that we can communicate using smartphones. And the unique thing about Twitter, okay, is that the message must be short. And I even asked the kids, I'm sure you guys know, how many characters can you use on Twitter? Only one actually knew in confirmation, 140 characters or less. So you must have a short message. Now, Jonah's sermon was only 46 characters long, so it would certainly work as a tweet, it's called. Okay? Jonah's sermon, all 8 words, was 40 more days, and Nineveh will be overthrown. Short and sweet, warning the people of Nineveh. Some napping worshipers might think that Jonah's short sermon is a miracle. But the real miracle was not that he preached such a wonderfully short sermon. The real miracle was that the whole city, we estimate the population of Nineveh to be about 120,000. The whole city listened to Jonah's sermon and repented. They took Jonah's warning to heart and they decided to turn from their wicked ways and instead walk in the path of God. What an effective sermon. Jonah, a prophet, a fearful man, a reluctant preacher, used only 8 words to change a city. And even after his sermon, Jonah was a reluctant believer who then, the story says, became angry. He became so angry that God would forgive the people who had been so evil. Jonah thought God's love was only for certain people. And Jonah had to learn that important lesson about God, that God loves everyone. Jonah got angry that the people turned from their wickedness, but even more angry that God decided not to destroy the people of Nineveh. Did you hear that? When Jonah finally did preach, and his sermon was effective, Jonah got mad because he didn't think that those people, we like to say that a lot, those people, he didn't think those people deserved the love and the forgiveness of God. So Jonah's very, very short sermon was effective, it was inspirational, and I decided that in honor of a short sermon, I'm going to summarize the story of Jonah down to just a capsule in 140 characters or less. If I were on Twitter, this is what I would say to summarize that short sermon. Jonah runs from God, who guides him back to tell. Jonah witnesses more miracles, yet still can't see that God's love is for everyone. That was 131 characters and a good summary, I think, of the story of Jonah. Jonah learned that day a lesson about God's love, a lesson about God's amazing grace and love. Jonah learned that day that God's love is not just for a select few, but for everyone. This week, one of my pastor friends, as we talked about preaching this story of Jonah and then tying it into All Saints Day, one of my pastor friends said, with just a sour taste in his mouth, "There is no way," he said, "I'm preaching about Jonah." And we thought it was just because it was All Saints Day and we were talking about how to fit it in. And he said, "I would never devote an entire sermon, an entire Sunday, to the story of Jonah." We said, "Why?" And he said, "I don't think Jonah deserves a Sunday all to himself. He was a rotten guy. So why preach about him, especially on All Saints Day," he said. And we all said, the pastors and I, "We think Jonah's perfect for a Sunday, perfect for All Saints Day, because this story is not about how great Jonah was. He was so reluctant, he hardly got there to do his job. He's not an obvious saint, okay? But this story is not about Jonah. It's more about the love of God, reminding us one more time that the love of God It's for everyone. Jonah is not an obvious saint. We think of somebody, when we think of a saint, on All Saints Day, we think of somebody who performs miracles or boldly, bravely goes to preach mighty sermons. Jonah is not a saint because of what he did or did not do. He was a reluctant preacher, a reluctant follower. What wins out for him is the grace and the mercy of a loving God. Jonah really wished that God would have crushed the city of Nineveh and all its residents. But the grace and the mercy and the forgiveness of God wins out one more time, even in the face of hard-hearted people who think that the circle of God's love is small. And God used Jonah to tell a story to us and show us one more time what the love of God is really like. And that grace of God, that amazing grace of God, is what makes us saints on this All Saints Day. And we remember how wide the circle of God's love goes to say they are all saints. Even to those we despise. That is something we should tweet about. In just a few minutes, we're going to light some candles that we have here on the edge of the altar, and we're going to name out this year 10 faithful, beloved members who are part of our journey here on earth. Some of them were just the most faithful of members, abounding in goodness. Others were complicated people who struggled through life. And yet others were probably just as reluctant as Jonah. But each and every one of these ordinary people we name as saints, not because of what they have done, but because of what God and God's love has done for them in their lives. And we remember and rejoice today that they are all beloved children of God. And since today we're going to come forward and we're going to light candles, remembering our own loved ones who died, and we're going to light them with hope. Those candles, we're going to light them with hope. Hope that we will be reunited with them again because of the amazing grace of God. And then today another beautiful thing is going to happen. Today we're going to create another beautiful saint when the baptismal waters are going to flow over the head of little Maverick, who's here in the front row. He has not done anything to deserve this, anything to earn it, but God is coming to him and naming him and claiming him as a beloved child of God. And for that, we give thanks to God as well. That same grace that makes Maverick a child of God is the same grace that made these 10 members of our church beloved saints. And it's the same grace of God that saved the entire city of Nineveh. The grace and the mercy and the forgiveness of God. And it's a grace that surprised Jonah and saves our beloved saints, and that same amazing grace of God thankfully makes us saints as well. And for that we rejoice and say thanks be to God. Amen. We're going to sing together hymn number 720 in your red hymnal, and then celebrate holy baptism.
Thank you.
I invite you all to turn in your bulletins to the last two pages where the order of service for baptism is found. Baptism is a gift from God, and it's in the waters of baptism that we are reborn children of God and given eternal life. We give thanks because baptism frees us from sin and death by joining us to Jesus Christ. At this time, I ask the baptismal sponsors to present their godchild. You presented Maverick for baptism, and then I ask you, will you share Christ's love with him? In your words and your actions, will you treasure him as a special gift from God? Will you care for him with the love of Christ? Will you pray for him that God's presence may fill his life? Will you teach him how much Jesus loves him? Will you teach him that he's a child of God forever? Will you bring him to the gathering of God's people so that he grows up worshiping and praising God? Will you teach him to pray? Will you introduce him to the scriptures and see that he's given every opportunity to grow in Christ? I ask you then to publicly take a stand for Christ. Do you renounce the forces of evil, the devil, and all his empty promises? And then with the whole congregation joining in, do you believe in God, our Creator, our Savior, our Counselor? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. If you'd hold him here over the water. Maverick Donald McDaniel, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we give you thanks for freeing your sons and daughters from the power of sin and for raising them up to a new life through this holy sacrament. Pour your Holy Spirit upon Maverick Donald, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence. Amen. If you turn him here towards me then. Maverick Donald McDaniel, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Amen. And then we present two things to you. We present this banner to you with these words. But now this is what the Lord says. He who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear. For I have redeemed you, I have called you by name, and you are mine. And then we light this candle and present it to you as well. And if you remember, it's one thing you can do on this anniversary of his baptism, is light it, maybe put it at the dinner table as a remembrance then for this holy day. And here I'll give this to you. You can light it on this anniversary of his baptism to remind him that this is the day that his faith journey started. And I present it with these words written in Matthew. Maverick, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Amen. And then we pray for you as parents. O God, the giver of all life, look with kindness upon Billy and Tricia, parents of this beautiful child. Let them ever rejoice in the gift that you have given to them. Make them to be teachers and examples of righteousness for their child. Strengthen them in their own baptism, so they may share eternally with their children the salvation you have given them through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then Members of Good Shepherd, you've witnessed this baptism of Maverick. Will you pray for him? Share your faith with him? Will you remind him that he belongs to Christ and that as Christ's people, we all belong to each other? And then I ask you to welcome him in the name of Jesus. And I'm going to take Maverick and introduce him to the congregation. I'm going to be careful with Maverick. He has a full tummy. I'm not going to bounce him much. Okay, this is Maverick Donald, named that by his parents. But we rejoice today that this is the newest member of Good Shepherd Lutheran Church, the newest member of the Christian Church, and he is now named Beloved Child of God. He is named a saint with us on this All Saints Day, and we rejoice that he has done nothing to earn this, but it is only by the amazing grace of God that he is. I'm not going to put him right over you. We rejoice that this is a pure gift from God. So please welcome him and rejoice in this wonderful gift. You want to say hi to him? The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please rise and greet one another with this peace which comes from God.
As you share your offering dollars, be mindful of the many ways that we at Good Shepherd have opened our doors to help feed our hungry community. For many years, we have opened up our kitchen and social hall on the first Tuesdays of the month for the free community supper. Your gifts allow us to generously open our doors to help feed our hungry community, and for this, we say thank you.
Thank you.
invite you to rise and sing together 184, hymn 184 in your red hymnal. To know and love and follow God, we pray now for the church, the world, and all those in need. Let us pray. Gracious Lord God, we give you thanks that you call us to follow you. Empower us to not run and hide, but to be faithful servants of your love. Thank you for your amazing grace and love and forgiveness, God. Lord, in your mercy, we give you thanks for Maverick, named today as a beloved child of God. We give you thanks for reaching out to him with your love. Bless him so that he may walk faithfully with you, God, all throughout his life. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Gracious Lord God, help us use our conscience as we vote this week. Help us remember to not get angry and worked up. Help us remember that no candidate is perfect. Help us to be grateful for the ability to vote, because not everyone in this world has that privilege. Help us remember that while this election has driven us crazy, we don't have to argue and we don't have to hate. And when Wednesday arrives, gracious God, help us work for unity, because we know that that is what you would want, God, unity on our land. Lord, in your mercy, may the memories of all your saints, God, be blessed. We pray for those who are dear to us who have died before us, and we give you thanks for the hope of a reunion. Lord, in your mercy, we pray, God, that you would be with all those who are in need this day. Be with those who grieve, as today we pray for the families of Rosalie Rasmussen and William Jacobson, who both died this past week. Be with people who are brokenhearted, those who are hungry for healing. Hold them close in your loving embrace, God. Restore those who are sick to wholeness, as today we lift up in prayer Donna Allen, who is now in hospice, Jan, Eldo, Kurt, Lester, Leonard, Bess, Cindy, and Velma, along with all those that we name now silently in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, trusting in your love and your healing, God, we commend to you all for whom we pray, knowing you hear and answer our prayers through Christ our Lord. Amen. And then it was in the night in which he was betrayed that our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, he broke it, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks. And he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It's shed for you. It's shed for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this to remember me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. I invite you to be seated at this time and then follow the directions of the ushers to come forward and commune. Remembering this, all are welcome to commune. And in addition to the regular wafers, we have gluten-free wafers. The empty cups will be filled with wine. The filled cups in the front have grape juice. Come, for all is ready.
Thank you.
May the body and blood of our risen Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. The Christian Church has set aside All Saints' Day so we can pause and remember all those who have gone before us. We reflect upon their lives. We give thanks that they are not gone from us forever, but that for us as Christians, we look forward to a reunion with them one day in heaven. So first we remember those Good Shepherd members who have died this past year, and we commend them to God. Richard Niebuhr. Bill Niebuhr. Beverly Klingbeil. Thomas Doc Wetzel. Vivian Way. Donald Zabel. Leona Harpestead. Pearl Shermer. Maureen Litke. Marion Hummer. Let us pray. Rest eternal grant them, O Lord, that they may be kept in communion with all the saints until we are reunited with them in your heavenly kingdom. Amen. At this time now, you're welcome to come forward and light a candle in memory of loved ones. You're welcome to take a candle from the plates here in front, light them off of the big Christ candle, and then place them in the sand in the boxes. And you're invited to sing along with hymn number 422.
Thank you.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, for our gracious, for our wonderful loved ones. We remember them, and we find strength and comfort today in your promise of life everlasting. Thanks be to God. Amen. Now may the Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever. Amen. We sing now one verse of Soon and Very Soon, and then the congregational meeting will be convened.